The Spook Who Sat by the Door by Sam Greenlee, Chapter 6. The general became genuinely fond of Freeman, and while continuing to use him as a showpiece, began to use him increasingly as an administrative assistant as well. He seldom gave Freeman tasks more difficult than those he might award a reasonably intelligent secretary, but that he requested him to do more than mop the floor was in itself progress of no little degree. Even the most bigoted of the general's friends and colleagues gave him credit for giving one of them an opportunity. It was as if the general had led the list in a drive for a popular charity. The general knew that Freeman would perform the task assigned him painstakingly, painfully, and accurately. Freeman, in turn, learned the trick of making an easy job look difficult, a talent he shared with the vast majority of government employees in Washington, regardless of color. The general began to take him on trips into the field more often, both at home and abroad. In the United States, of course, he would have his secretary inquire as to whether a Negro in their midst might offend anyone. Only a relative number of replies in the affirmative were received, confirming the general's pride in the progress of race relations. Freeman was often used as a liaison between the general and Senator Hennington, and their mutual relations improved considerably. The senator would often invite Freeman to lunch in the Senate dining room. The senator liked to lunch on the Hill with a Negro at least two or three times a month, and often would be stuck with one who looked white, a wasted effort in image making. Nowadays, the presence of Negroes in the Senate dining room seldom evoked any dramatic response from the Southern senators, as had been the case early in the senator's career, thus taking much of the drama and pleasure from the adventure. But the senator's reputation as a flaming liberal crusader for human rights remained intact, and Freeman made his small contribution, making only one minor faux pas by once requesting a wine in a good French accent. The senator did not notice, and Freeman made a mental note that knowing anything at all about wines was not part of his image. The senator, flattered by Freeman's feigned ignorance and naivety, told everyone that Freeman was an extremely intelligent man. Freeman moved through Washington like an invisible man. He was an occasional, though not frequent, guest at Georgetown cocktail parties for African diplomats. He was seldom invited to sit-down dinners, not because the Georgetowners objected to eating with Negroes. They all did it several times a year, but to save him the embarrassment of which fork and spoon to use for which course. His blackout from Washington Black Society, the most snob-ridden of a snob-ridden class in America, was total. It was as he wished. While Freeman could regard whites with a certain objectivity and controlled emotion, the black middle class and their mores sent him up the wall. He dated seldom, and if there was a recurrence of the relationship, it was usually confined to bed. The Washington Negro woman found much to fault Freeman in dress and cool, but little to complain about in bed. He seldom maintained a liaison more than a few months at a time. He still used the Dahomey Queen, now moved up the whore's social ladder to the point where she was a high-priced car girl with a clientele consisting mainly of Southern congressmen. She specialized in several sadistic variations, for which she charged extra. Her relationship with Freeman had become warm and personal, in spite of the fact that she knew nothing about him. She enjoyed his company, and increasingly she enjoyed sleeping with him. Men would never be her scene, but she knew by now that Freeman offered no threat and made no attempt to use the power her sexual enjoyment gave him. It intrigued her, and she enjoyed the relationship they had. Freeman studied the reports of the guerrilla fight in Algeria, particularly as confined to urban centers, the guerrilla war against the Hucks in the Philippines, the guerrilla war against the Malayan communists, the tactics of the Viet Cong, the theories of Giap and Mao Zedong. He accompanied the general to Saigon four times as the war escalated. He stayed in the Hotel Caravel, the air conditioning so high that you had to wear a jacket or a sweater. He had cocktails on the roof terrace among the correspondents who were trying to turn the day's ration of rumors, gossip, and USIS and PIO propaganda into a meaningful dispatch. He ate in Vietnamese restaurants, several of the good French restaurants, in a Japanese restaurant set in a Japanese design garden across town from the hotel. He learned to walk slowly the other way when a crowd surged towards the scene of carnage created by terrorists, to watch as if a cyclist had an egg more lethal than those laid by hens in the basket of his bike. He bought a set of Danish-style stainless ware in Japan, a Japanese camera in Hong Kong, Thai silk in Bangkok. He had suits made by Jimmy Chen in Kowloon, which he had shipped to his New York apartment. He became adept with chopsticks and learned to make love in several languages. He found that in Asia he was not as hip in bed as he had imagined, and took a postgraduate course in sex, Oriental style. He was enjoying the job, its prerogatives, and put it on so many white people, but the general saved him from any addiction in that direction. They were driving back to Langley from the capital when the general decided to take his assistant to lunch. He almost requested that the driver stop at his club. Although the club had no colored members, it was no oddity to see dark faces there several times a year. Only recently, there had been a Nobel Prize winner, an operatic star, a federal judge, and the president of Howard University. But Freeman might be uncomfortable in the impressive surroundings of the club. The general ordered the driver to take them to a good, moderately priced steakhouse instead. They were ushered in and taken to an excellent table. It was the first time in several visits that Freeman had not been seated by the toilet or the kitchen. Freeman ordered a martini on the rocks, the general bourbon and branch water while they awaited their steaks.
"Dan, I want to say how pleased I am at the way you fitted into the agency. To be frank, I had my reservations at first, but they've been completely eliminated by your performance. If more of your people were like you, there would be much less difficulty."
The general took a sip of his drink, rolled it on his tongue a moment before swallowing, then made a 10 of his fingers.
"Honest sweat and toil. Pull yourself up by the bootstraps like the immigrants. These demonstrations and sit-ins stir up needless emotion. Your people must demonstrate a respect for law and order. Earn the respect and affection of whites. Take yourself as an example. A fine natural athlete. No denying you people are great athletes."
"Yes," said Freeman. "And we can sing and dance too."
"Right. In the fields of sports and entertainment, you're unsurpassed, but you must admit there's still a social and cultural gap to be closed. The Africans did develop centuries later than the Europeans, you know. As I've said, you're a fine athlete, but I think you would have to admit your intellectual shortcomings. It will take generations, Dan. It's not a question of prejudice, but rather one of evolution."
Their steaks arrived, and Freeman fought to keep his down. He had no appetite now, and he willed his hands not to tremble. He had not ordered wine because he thought the Spartan general might consider it an affection. He sipped the Kohl Carlsberg, taking a deep breath as he replaced the glass. He forced himself to look at the general, masking his seething emotions. He surprised himself by summoning a smile.
"I'm encouraged after knowing you, Dan. You're a credit to your race. Perhaps your generation will achieve more by example than your civil rights leaders can hope to accomplish through turmoil and agitation."
Somehow, Freeman got through the meal. He excused himself as the general ate his dessert of apple pie a la mode and was violently ill in the toilet. He washed his face and saw how pale he had become in the washroom mirror, but he didn't think anyone as colorblind as the general would notice. The general allowed Freeman to leave the office early that day, and he reached his apartment ahead of rush hour traffic. He mixed a stiff scotch and lay sipping it in a very hot tub while listening to Dina Washington. Well into his second drink, he watched the 6 o'clock news, the big mounted cops charging the children with cattle prods, the police dogs and fire hoses, one long shot of a little girl bowled over by the battering stream of water and spun along in the gutter like a bowling pin. The freedom songs and praying, all the wasted, martyred faith and courage of a people who wouldn't quit. It had to be channeled where it would be most effective, where it might make Whitey back off. It was time to stop procrastinating, time to do what he had to do. He had all the training he needed. He walked into his bedroom, made a list of social welfare agencies in Chicago, and wrote letters of inquiry concerning job openings. He discovered his hands had stopped trembling and that he was calmer than in years. He requested an appointment with the general the next day. Freeman told him he had been profoundly impressed by the general's talk at lunch the day before. He felt he could make a greater contribution to his people by returning to Chicago and working among them, and the general had shown him the way. The general reluctantly agreed that perhaps following his own advice might indeed be the best for Freeman to do. The general walked Freeman to the door of his office while haughtily booming cliches concerning Freeman's grand sense of duty. He closed the door behind Freeman, frowned briefly, walked to his desk, and phoned his director of training and personnel, informing him that they would need another Negro sometime within the next year. He hung up and returned to the direction of the Cold War. End of chapter 6.